today. I guess when I play ranked again, I'll continue stuff. I do a video on meta decks. Someone asked me this question before. Maybe it was you, for all I know. I don't really have... One, the meta changes a lot, because of the maps and whatever else. And... I don't really have all the... I have enough items I could do, like, a replication, or, like, a fair representation of them, but I don't... I'm probably making excuses, because I'm lazy, but also like, yeah, the meta really changes a lot, and I don't play enough to have a good feel for it. Yeah, because a lot of people will have different things. It's going to be hard for me to talk about, like, play strategy and stuff until I actually play them, and that's a lot. You will just see a wide variety of stuff. That's all I can really say about meta. Expect warriors. Expect wizards. Expect priests. There's a lot of different possible combinations, and you see a lot of people experiment and do a lot of things, and yeah. And again, meta, it's different elo brackets have their own meta and, like, more common builds and stuff, so, like, it's just crazy shit everywhere. Yeah, it's really hard to say. If you want an idea of what good decks look like, spectate 1600 plus. 1600 plus. That'll give you a good feel for good decks. What good decks look like, and, like, good players as well. 1600 plus, especially for, like, good, for observing good player play. Fifteen hundred's an okay bed price. 1500, there's a lot of difference in 1500, I feel, as well. Like, 1500, yes, you're a good player, but there's still pretty big gradient on what good is. And, of course, I have impossibly high standards for everyone and myself, so. Yeah, hope that was helpful. No, it wasn't. Hope it was an amusing excuse for stuff. Like, okay, I'm rambling, might as well talk about it right now, like. And there are recent nerfs, right? Elf maneuver nerfs, so elf warriors are gonna look a little bit different. It's not gonna be caution mobility everywhere, but it might be anyways, just because of the two traits. You don't know. So I did save this team. So, like, I just build. I don't know. What I do know, like, common items, good items you'll see from priests, especially dwarf. Expect Evensong. Human possibly as well. But I think dwarf, especially because of the HP. Human priests are probably going to be the most. Human priests are the most common priests. And that, who knows? But in a two warrior, one priest party, there you should expect Evensong. Greater Heal is very much in fashion right now. As is Bless. As is, like, a lot of stuff. But, like, my deck building reflects that, because I see other people, I notice what they're doing, I notice what's, like, seems painful, what makes me sad, / mad, and stuff. So, and I'm try hard and super serious and boring. So I do all the boring stuff. I think this is a reference in, like, okay, not this team, but a lot of item choices I look at, especially for a more typically standard team, like the aggro thing. Like, these are all... Okay. Standard choice. Reasonably standard choice. Very standard choice. Also pretty standard choice. Less so since Evensong came out. Depends on the build. dwarves especially will love this, but Tome of Mars Blessing is just really good anywhere. Typically, this will be Advanced Piety. 2 Altruism, Greater Heal for a blue token. Elves! Okay, no one does elves, so this is a very bad party for that. Vibrant Pain Warriors probably don't always look like this. I still have a good number of steps, so I think Caution Mobility might still work out for me. This is the team I use to get hit 1800. 6, 9, 3, 6, 8, 11 moves. Like, yeah, I think Caution Mobility might still be good for these guys. And again, just 2 traits at tokenless. You can't go wrong. It's basically Raging Battler. It's functioning like Raging Battler. Warriors! Vibrant Pain. Duh. This is like super old school build. Double-edged sword is really good. Bejeweled short sword is still really good. I haven't seen Bejeweled short sword much. Nova Axe is very much a thing. Cause awesome damage. Laser thrust, awesome damage. Purging strike, nice tech. O chop and violent spin, randomly super amazing. Slice and dice is a really good weapon that I haven't seen that much use of. It's a very much competitor with double-edged sword and arguably white katana if you want the sundering strike tech. But a lot of people go with Troll's Ire for sundering strike on weapons. So like a really common weapon setup, Vibrant Pain, Strong Arm, Troll's Ire. And that gives people a lot of tokens to use elsewhere. I have no idea what wizards look like nowadays. I have not played wizards in a long time. Not good wizards. I don't know if burst is still a thing. I imagine burst should be a thing. I've said this before at some point. I think burst should be a thing still. We saw Gula Gula earlier do stuff like... Alright, we saw Gula Gula, Blue Destruction, Heart Ripper. Get the AoE stuff, and then when people come in, bam, smack for a million. Martyrs is somewhat in fashion, like the Asian Knight has like cushioning, armor plus Martyr's Blessing plus a lot of healing. And Heart Ripper, great against Martyrs, not so good against punishing or cushioning, but wizards will have some armor hate that dissolve armor, or more reasonably a Khan's Amulet for boiling armor. I'm super rambly right now, so if you have questions, just fire away. Flash of Agony nerf, now that hits yourself, does make this a little less desirable and a little bit more awkward for sure, but Fireball's still good, right? In Human Priest, they have leadership. You can get rid of your Flash of Agonies. Deadly is really good. You're not going to have the luxury of always hitting around corners slash have that sort of sneaky 7 range because the Arcane Burst rate 6 plus the 1 from the Burst. So Arcane Burst and Ember Burst is like an effective 7 range. Searing Pain, Fireball Burst 2, effective 8 range. But what Deadly has, you've hard to block, which is going to be annoying for folks. You can sometimes hit around corner with good positioning, which is why the elf with Deadly is actually quite good. I really enjoyed having the elf with Deadly. I could position myself for good Deadly Sparks, slash, because of my, you know, pass a lot, then move towards the end. Elf benefits from that as well, right? Just move with the dash, you can move, you can cover a lot of ground, do good things. With the Electroporter Novice nerf, Where is it? Rah. Seriously, what the hell? Oh, right, none of my guys aren't... Where? What? Electro... Here, Here it is. So this got nerfed, right? This used to be a spark generator. This is now a powerful spark. This... probably not... this is no longer the go-to thing. It's still good, right? Two trades at tokenless. A lot of skills are just like that. But I think Fogg's Electromancy is probably going to be your best arcane skill. Unless you're burning, right? Burning Wizards, of course, they take Focus Pyromancy. But, for Burst Shenanigans, like this kind of setup, or even with the Gulo Gulo, right? Blue Destruction Heart Ripper, you go Focus Electromancy. I bet that was what he was running, because this stuff. With this on, your stuff is. It's unblockable, slash, this does a lot of extra damage. It's so good. It's so good. Right, even when Electroporter Novice was awesome, I still spent the token for this because Spark Generator is, this skill is amazing for this kind of setup. But let's look at tokenless, because there are other there is some competition around, probably. There is, if you wanted the Spark Generators, I guess you could go with this one. There's something with two-dimensional Travelers probably somewhere. Reasonable alternative for Fire Wizards. Hey, Math! Yeah, this one. This is pretty darn good as well. Wizards, you should be hanging back to begin with, so defenses hopefully won't bite you too hard, but when those elves come crashing in, it could be iffy. But three trades at tokenless? Totally reasonable. Totally reasonable. I am super rambly right now. I was just like, oh, talk about meta decks or whatever, and I just like... yeah, I just started rambling. So if you have questions, slash, you're also really strong, so you can obviously contribute a lot. Boop. Hmm. We'll go down here for now, while we talk about, the items. So yeah. Very worth considering. Is there a better version of that one? I feel like there should be. That's the same. Yeah, this one. This is... depending on this, this is probably what you're going to be looking for. This one. Like, Dimensional Traveler, it's really nice. Just that one, that extra movement helps you ignore terrain, gives you some breathing room against warriors or something, etc. And the Force Bolt random dinky control spell, totally reasonable. Like, this may be the new tokenless for wizards in general, like your most general vague wizard, whatever that is, like, this is probably what you want. Right here. What do vamps look like? Good question. Defense, no. That's not good. What do vampires look like? I do have a few random vamp builds, but it's old school, and there are a lot of different ways to go about this as well. I like the elf thing, because, you know, that's me. But all the different races are all good candidates. Where is my... here we go. So yeah, this was like 2 years ago. It was very old. But, so feel free to update this however the hell you'd want, but they'll look... oh, this is awkward. That was not good. This is not... well, do I have a 111 priest team somewhere? Oh, I'm supposed to build with this. Okay, well, let's take a look at what each... what each thing looked like. And actually, I'm gonna be boring and advertise. So, if it's a human priest, as Matt's saying, having all three with team movement helps a lot. If you give them all, say, perfect or bloody or trainee or... Oh, okay, so delegate make haste is actually a really good option now as well to consider. Or even regular command. These are all totally fine human skills to have on basically any human priest. Vampire, right, if you're supporting, yeah, anyone, these are all good. But the vampires having three human vampires able to push each other around, really, really nice. Delegate is a big one. Gives them some extra movement, because again, priests are typically movement challenged. Depending on stuff, boots. Hawkwind is good for just pure movement. Chem Cedric is awesome. You got the team moves. You can go very stabby. So if you have someone with, like, say, Captain Cedric, so you can go very stabby. Nunchaku is something I like, but maybe not everyone's cup of tea. Good weapons include Healing Hand Mace for big damage. Obviously, Vampire's Blade, that's like the signature one, and it's amazing because it's tokenless with two traits, with a lot of drains. Awesome. Matt says Healing Dash for cantrip, which is very fun. Turquoise Boots is usually one option people like. Queen of Sword gets you in there, Striking Cloth helps you, you know, lets you also move in as well as Healing Dash for the cantrip. Depending on how you want to do it, it's obviously either Focus Healer or Manifold Healer, depending on tokens and etc. Other good options at blue would be, this is one of those things where like sliding at yellow and diamond moccasins at blue, also very much worth considering. Sparkling Cloth, Quick Run for massive cantrip-y goodness, Sliding Boots, Team Movement, and the Sparkling Cloth, really good. That's probably what you'll see. I'm personally a huge fan of the turquoise boots, but it does work really well for people. It is a strong option to consider for VAMs. So, weapons, right, Nunchaku, Vampire's Blade, Healing Hand Mace, what else? Chaozu's Hammer! This one worth considering as well to help save some tokens. Let's bring some stuff down here. And after that, I don't really know, actually. Oh, Binzers? God damn it, legendaries. So, like, depending on how stabby you want to be, right, you could do Binzers and Dark Force, which is something I've done before. So this is very much like a stab-oriented build. And you have stuff like Hand of Melvilus, Glass on Stark Skull to round out the divine items. Lifesuck Spear is a good cheap vampire option, yes. And extra movement and some hard-hitting stuff, totally good, totally good. I like going super all-in, so you'll see me do stuff like two vampire blades and then just fill everything out with stuff. But yeah, Lifesuck Spear, very good option. You'll be less super combo-y, like, because with the cantrip, you get to cantrips plus drains, you can just one-shot someone, essentially. Have some buffs somewhere. So you have less of that combo potential, but extra moves is nice, and some random hard hits, like especially the Impaling Stab, can be very nice to have. You suck at using uncommon items. Well, this is actually... I really recommend people play Peasant for this reason. You find a lot of cool things that you wouldn't otherwise consider. And some of which are actually totally viable at high elo ratings, maybe. Again, I default to legendary because I'm lazy, it's right here, and there's a... Legendaries have a lot of more unique, interesting combinations, but... Common, uncommon, there's still a lot of solid, good stuff worth considering. For all classes. People say... Right, common myth, oh, you need a lot of epics and legendaries for wizards to work? No. 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 They can do stuff. Give them a chance. You have to try. You actually have to try in deck build. And really, just go through. Just think about what... Like... Yeah. Yeah. It is harder. You do have to think more, as Math is saying, but... Totally worth it. Super fun. You'd be surprised. I guarantee you'd be surprised. Like, you can hit 1500 with Peasant. I snuck into 1600 somehow. Toot. Why do I say stuff? Yeah. You'd be surprised. Yeah, you might have to try a little bit harder in game, but you make things work. Yeah, Glimmer Boots. Tokenless with trait. Totally fine on a wizard. Damage on Peasant Wizard is harder. It's typically going to be control focused. You might have to do some funny stuff like Man Melter. Staff of Chaos is epic, dude. What are you talking about? So this one's hilarious. Flax really likes this one. Gulo does too. This is decent. You get the Mighty Sparks? I'm a really big fan of Counterblast. Again, probably more of a control-y wizard kind of thing, but these three hit hard. Jarring Block, Random Block is nice. Forgetfulness, you find a way. Right, Block Shag, or randomly just stuffing an enemy wizard. It's pretty awesome. Funny. Crazy. Pairwood might be okay for the control stuff, but beware of Fright. It's really scary. I'm scared of it. This could be cute. If you can catch a lot of people, could be cute. At comp, Dynamic Staff is interesting. The little steps. Hawkglass, great if you want dumb traits. And hey, Fireball, people don't seem to like Searing Pain anymore. Super budget, Staff of Chask, you got the two pushback parries and some other cards. Probably not what you really want. Man Meltzer, I love this thing. Delightfully random. Nice stuff. Damage. Love it. So that's an option. This is pretty decent at double blue. Right, nice utility moves, Arcane Beam, it's a line! Hit people! Hell, Force Cannon can be amazing, especially against a dwarf. It's a nice package, it's fun, it's a cool item. Don't know if it's how good it'd be, but it always seems cool. Okay. And that's it. But there's stuff! There's totally stuff! If you want to be a little bit less crazy with the Man Melter, you can go this. You get a nice block out of it. And you got humans with leadership, you can do weak strikes, you can pitch weak strikes. Right, Twix did something like that with these and got 1700. There's stuff. Oh, there's a random staff somewhere that I only have like a one of, but I thought it was real good. Oh, where's Oak Staff? This thing is also awesome. Look at this. Look at this. This is great. No, not that. This is great. Wizards. They can do stuff. Back to vampires. Shields, it's still basically Aegis or Parrying Buckler. But, ooh, more cantripy goodness. This is new. Like, generally, Shields, 95 plus percent of the time, it's Parrying Buckler or Aegis the Defender, right? There are other good options. This is pretty solid, especially against Wizards. I like this one. Sorry to hear that lucky dice. Pretty decent, depending on the build. Awesome. Still good tokenless, great tokenless option against Warriors. I'm not cooking any lucky dice, I'm just rambling super hard about builds, what they might look like, etc. So we're looking at possible variants on vampires. For here, options include this one for armor. I'm a big fan of this one. Oh wow, nice math. This is very, very fashionable. Pretty much the thing people like. This is a good option. Frenzy Aura, the vampire attacks typically hurt a lot less. So having a way to buff your own damage helps a lot. This is a great one, gets around the armor as well. So, screw you, reliable mail, screw you, questioning armor, etc. Martyr's Blessing, awesome, especially on vampires since you're healing yourself. I mean, this will be on someone else, but like if you have two vampires and then one supporty priest, like this is a great one to have. You can buff the other vampire. Hell, you can even put on your support priest, have them soak up some hits or whatever. Team heal, cantrip. Cantrip! Cantrip! It's great! Yeah, I'll get to that in a second. This one, Nightforged Plate, new tokenless armor. You have the heal, you have nice armor to help keep yourself alive in case something gets blocked or whatever, and a trait! A semi-negligible trait, but kind of awkward. Yeah, I totally agree. Traits are nice, and this is a great one. If you want a trait, you can do this one. It's totally nice. Heavy armor, the encumber might be annoying because of priests' generally low movement. That is something to watch out for. And unlucky, especially if you're running like Aegis. Really awkward if you're counting on defender's block to work and you get unlucky. And something unlucky pops up. Like, then you're super unlucky! That could be really weird. Jet armor, great option as well. We get the frenzy aura. We have a traveling curse, which is good because you can heal up. They can't, hopefully. And then, more damage. This is a great one. This is a great one. Yes, lucky dice. Yeah, you get a frenzy aura on dwarves with unlucky, and then have like essentially permanent frenzy aura. That's really awesome. And we'll get to dwarves in a sec. This is, if you're going with like a two vampire, one support priest setup, this is a good one to have on the support priest. We just talked about why Martyr's Blessing is good. You should know why Martyr's Blessing is good. This makes sense. And a tokenless is also a good option because of, hey, more drains. Inky Fingers loves this one. And hey, that Invigorating Touch really hurts Warriors if it lands, especially when buffed. It just hurts so much. That's probably what you're usually going to see from the Warriors. Peasant version, where's Mail of Succor? This is a nice one to have if you're on more of a budget, even though this one's really good. But this is another option if you want some healing. Again, you get the cantrip and the dynamic armor. Big movement. So this is worth considering. I don't think, it's not as good as these other ones, but it's an option. Up to you guys to try it out. Nice tech card. Nice techie divine armor. Yeah. Oh yeah, this is also just tokenless reliable mail. Bam. That's a totally fine one. If it's a wizard heavy meta, you could consider this one as well. The Cleansing Ray gets cantrip. And some card draw if it works. If you really want that extra Spear of Darkness, I guess you could do this, but you're not really going to see that one. This might be an alternative, but Bless is generally going to be better than Unholy Energy, but could consider this one for the Invigorating Touch as well. So let's talk about dwarves since people were mentioning it. If you go all dwarves, you get Perfect Ferocity. Why, hello there. Really nice. Blind Rage and Frenzy Aura, big damage. If you get the unlucky with the Knife Forge Plate, it could be hilarious. But if you get the heavy armor, then And if all dwarves, then Dwarven Battlecry, very, very, very good, obviously. When in doubt, though, if you have the Raging Battler, why bother, it's still really good. For that tokenless 2 Blind Rage, hell, Apprentice Ferocity, even with the nerf, for an unreliable block, if you want the Blind Rage, if you want 2 Blind Rages at tokenless, still a fine option. Chess Beast Dwarf or Zombie Dwarf? Reflects how brainless they are. Otherwise, more cantrip-y stuff? Oh, discard all cards. Okay, never mind. You don't want this. You don't want to pitch your thing. But hey, movement, anti-control spells, anti-melee. This is a good option, good budget option to have for Dwarf. Lucky Dice is saying stuff like Raging Rock somewhere. Yeah, if you have the token, this is good. If you're all dwarves, you might want to have one of the dwarves. You could have consider having one of the dwarves have Advanced Ferocity for Warcry to get rid of pesky blocks. Again, parry is really, really hurt on vampires because they want all their hits to land. Especially when buffed because their hits don't hit for that much, but they especially want... Vampires especially want their attacks to connect because they get the life gain. You sort of want to... When you go in on a fight against a warrior, you don't want to attack first with their turns. You want to let them hit you, so then you get max value out of it. Sometimes you do want to hit first, but... And especially if like a combo kill, but... And the Warcry, if you get rid of blocks, that will help with a combo kill, but... In general... You probably just want... Yeah. You want to let them hit you, so then you can touch them back for a lot. Warcry lets... guarantees the touch, unless there's a defender somewhere. A fine option for dwarves in general at blue. 2 blocks and the toughness. Cool. And Solid Rock, also very, very good. Typically not what you're going to see on a vampire, though, I think. Perfect Ferocity, or one of the 2 Blind Rages. That's probably going to be your best bet. That's what you're going to most likely see. Spear stuff, going to be more important on dwarves because of their... because of their size and stature, so... And you don't even necessarily need the Nunchaku, right? But they have the Frenzy Aura, such Blind Rage, more damage, the spears, the extra range is really nice, and it hits for a lot, so like, this stuff gets really scary. Hand of Melvilus. So yeah, you could, depending on your items, you could go like... That, like, 3 of these. If you need a sub, go with the Flax Thirsty Vial. Or this as well. If you want to be a bit more on the survivey side, and Greater Heal is will help you survive, especially with the cantrip, pretty bonkers, so. Yeah, divine items to watch for. This, these 3. If you have the token, you can use to upgrade a Hand of Melvilus, essentially. Or this, rather, right? If you're a spear focused kind of thing. Supporty Priest, again, I usually see vampires as either two vampires and a support priest, or like a regular warrior, then vampire, and then a supporty priest. So the support priest build accordingly, but make sure you have some mass frenzies there. Unless dwarf, then you could skip that. Lucky Dice says, I'd rather use Kristoff's instead of Glasshaw's Dark Skull. Very bad gift. This is the same as Kristoff's. For the random cause fumble, that is a very fair point. That's totally good. That's totally good. Oh, right. Other options. Draining console. This is a big one. For a lot of invigorating touches, like elves might really like this one, for example. Humans too. Dwarves, yeah, everyone would like it. So if you want like max invigorating touches, like you can do three of these, have the put this one there, some vampire's blades. Is there stuff I'm missing? Yeah. That's all good. Oh yeah, healing beacon does cantrip as well. If you see that heal with the underline, it'll cantrip from a focus healer. Make sure someone has purge somewhere, so ritual straps or this or purging charm. Purging charm might be okay just because it has an enervating touch on it. I use this one a lot because I don't always want to have the spell send the token for spell stripper relic, the three purging bursts. But this is definitely one to consider. Depending on stuff, this is still okay. Trait that you can hopefully mitigate since you're draining, you get a drain, you get a buff. If you want to be funny, this one. Traits that, again, you'll hopefully drain up. Big buff. You probably won't see most people do this, but there is potential. There is potential here. Okay, now if we start to talk about elves, so this is elves I have the most experience with. I really, really love healthy trickery as the elf skill of choice. But there are still other arguments for, I don't know. But superb footwork, quick runs, super mobility. Hell, even insight, whatever that is, or escapist. This one's good still, and if you just want traits, there's still caution mobility, and there's always Elven Scamper, this one, if you want. What the shit? Okay, Lucky, are you serious? Do you not see how this is amazing for Elf Vampire? We got a trait. That's good. We have trickery, so they can't hurt us, and it's a movement, so we get in, they can't hurt us as much, then we can drain back. Healing dash, cantrip! This is awesome. This is awesome. I really like this one. That's just, again, this is just how I build. I don't see vulnerable as big of a deal, as much of an issue as a lot of other players for some reason. Could be wary. Like, if it pops up and there's wizards, but you find a way. The fun thing with, if you have multiple vampires, is that you can drain each other to just redistribute health around. Drain your own guys, keep everyone healthy. Totally fine. Oh my god, I'm really hungry. Oh, there's no water. But yeah. Elves. So, for an elf, I'd do something like this and this, probably? You get your healing dash, you still have the sparkling cloth for a lot of good movement, team walk helps everyone, flank move, etc. Yeah, that totally was first world problems, wow. I'm so American. But yeah, since these guys can get in, wait, I talked about burst already, Jet. I was talking about wizards. I already did that. But yeah, healing hand mace. Smack with probably a vampire's blade. That's pretty good. Again, Chelchu is nice for techie stuff, but This elf can very much go in. You can play Stabby Stabs as well. Nothing wrong with that. You know, stuff like that. That's what an elf vampire would look like. Did you do Mind Worms, Pyreus, with Elf Priests? Is that something you did? Like, did you, like, is that actually a thing you did that went really well? Really? Tanglist is funny. I agree. For those of you who aren't in the know, look at this beauty. Card advantage. It's all good, Jet. I mean, I just talked about the staves. I didn't talk about the priest. Priest is whatever. Wow! That's really impressive. So wait, then Pyreus, what did you do? Did you just, like, Mind Worm and just run around forever and then, like, slowly pop? And then, like, what the hell? Really? Did you combo with Trickery or something? Like, still impressive. Hey, I'm not getting back into 1800 for, like, ever. So, what is okay, you know what's something we can do? What do support priests look like? They're probably human. There's probably, okay, this is, let's get a refresh. Interesting, Pyreus. Huh. That sounds like a fun kind of thing. Alright, now yes, as Lucky Dice and Math have already stated, support priests depends what you're gonna look like. Let's go through them in order then. Again, almost really human, but it will depend. I like elves just because elves. Other folks like dwarves because I don't know. HP, Dwarven Bork, Dwarven Battlecry, stuff like that. But okay, let's start with warriors, because that's what I know. As I've said multiple times by now, Evensong very popular. Quick Totals popular. Depending on build, Blanco for the Inspiring Presence. Wow. Pyreus. St. Ulf's. So if you want Mass Frenzy at blue-blue, it's St. Ulf's. At blue-yellow, you get with totals. At double yellow, you get Evensong. Depending on stuff people like, Nimbus Blade or Duality Mace for the Nimbus is really nice. Is an option. I'm not a huge fan of it, but if you see Nimbus, this kind of thing will probably happen. And Nimbus Blade is better than Duality Mace, so if you have the Nimbus Blade and you like the Nimbus, you go with the Nimbus Blade. My favorite super techie item at blue-blue, you always see me talking about this when I deck build because it just does everything! Nice tech, because armor's annoying, you get some purges which are still really essential, and a nice random Inspiring Presence and Lunging Bash, random movement, random blowout when you heal everyone, it's great! It's great! Yeah. Darkblood Glaive, if you're supporting Burst Wizards. Okay, we'll get to that later. First Warriors. I can stay focused. this is cool, this is cute, no one runs this. But it's really cool. And it definitely has potential. White Glow Flail was used quite a bit a long time ago, before the Nimble Strike nerf. Now I still wonder how useful it is. It's weird. But I don't think you really see White Glow Flail. Oh right, Zeril's Mace is super popular right now. Super popular right now. Again, the tech, the heals, the block checks, does a lot. I do not have a Cudgel of Wrath. Some folks like the Cudgel of Wrath, which is, it's a legendary tokenless, 3 controlled overswings, 2 unholy frenzy, and 1 blind rage. Very reasonable. If you want your support priest to hit a bit harder, you can go like St. Portia's Maul or Dark Druid's Mace. Get some big stuff. Yeah, Sacrificial Axe. I really like Sacrificial Axe as a nice, good tokenless option. Again, vulnerable, if you're a support priest, you hang in the back, and that's okay. Altruism, surprise damage, nice techie control related stuff. Depending on what you might want, you could still go with Vampire's Blade. If you're afraid of vulnerable, you could go with the Loner, and this does help you with warriors slash stuff. Yeah, tokenless, these are probably your best options, especially for support priest. After that, I don't really know. I don't know what people... Oh! Purging Mace. If you need purges, you say hi to Purging Mace. Yeah. Yeah, that's typically what you'll see. I think for the supporting priest, it's typically what you'll see for both warriors and wizards. Warriors, especially like the frenzy ones, they probably like this Inspiring Presence one more too. Wizards, for wizards, and Purging Mazes is really good if you need the purges for wizards. If bursts, then Dark Blood Glaive. So Savage Curse, like 6 damage fireballs, and 6 damage arcane bursts, whatever, 7 damage deadly spark, still really good. It still hurts. So I think that's very much still a weapon worth considering for burst, even though I haven't played burst since the nerfs. But like, look at all this! It's just amazing! This is so amazing. Good density of buffs, and like, these are all really good, like, wow. What an item. Yes, Nizla really likes Knife of Saint Blanco. I think she might have gone with 2 of them, but like, what she does is Inspiring Presence with cushioning. So obviously if you're taking 5 at most, and then Inspiring Presence heals it back and stuff. Oh yeah, so for supporting warriors, this is a strong option to consider if you have it. For the reasons we stated, you get the Frenzy, Altruism, and the nice Inspiring Presence. So like Masuzo, you'll just have the Elf Warriors be in front, be nice and scary, put a Priest at 3 squares back, Aegis, Inspiring Presence, does all that good stuff. So for Warriors, this is one, definitely one to consider. Blended Skull, if you want all the Frenzies, great. Some people like Frenzy Charm, I do not like Frenzy Charm. It just feels like too much big stuff, meh. Thanks for tuning in, Lucky Dice, see you around, sleep well. Frenzy Medallion, a little bit better, just because you want the Mass Frenzies instead of just the Unholy Frenzy. 1-1-1 builds, Frenzy Tome is really awesome because the Savage Curse, randomly great for the Priest, randomly great for the Wizard, randomly great for the Warrior, and there's only one of, so it's nice. And as people are saying, yes, Triple Heal's great for block checking, I do that a lot. As you should, it does that. It's great. For Burst, Skull of Salvage Illgen. I imagine still totally reasonable. Math reads my mind. Slash, no, I'm reading his text. If you want Tomeless Mass Frenzy, I like Shuddering Relic over Frenzy Charm. Because you get the trait, and I don't like having support beasts be like full support. I do like having support beasts be able to do some damage. So, burp. You get the nice little drain there. Messed up Warrior Math. Yeah, go home, Frenzy Charm. Go home. Less! Hey, that's good for everyone. All kinds of builds like Less. Martyr's Blessing, as I said earlier, Tome of... That doesn't help, but... Martyr's Blessing, very great for Warriors, still fine for Wizards. But, yeah, Martyr's really good. What else? If you like your healing and the altruism stuff, this is an option as well. I feel like there's better, but this is totally fine. This is also an okay option. Definitely like a budget option of the Mass Frenzy ones, but having the inspirations like can be potentially amazing with altruism to get a lot of cards, and so the Mass Frenzy, the inspiration, it's great to pass without passing, right? Just sort of just see what's up. If Nimbus, I guess Shielding Token, but you really don't see Nimbus at high elos. Pretty rare, very rare, very infrequent. Again, for supporting stuff, Spellstripper Relic, good, and there's the Purging Charm as the tokenless alternative. So definitely good to have some Purge in your deck somewhere. Note how there's all these possible things you can do with Support Priest. There's so many ways to build them, so many things to account for. It's weird because it's like... I think if you're starting out, if you're lower in the elos, just focus on having a focus deck. And just focus on making a deck that's focused, has a good game plan, that, yeah, and play that deck, try and figure out the strengths and weaknesses for yourself, and just get a feel for situations and stuff, but just play the game, just have fun playing the game. And you learn a lot from there. And as you get better, as you just play, you'll suddenly... Oh, hey, whoa, we got a bunch of items, and then you can start to experiment. I think at first, just build, have some focus, and then later on, sneak in these purges and, like, maybe random bless or whatever else. But first, start focus, and then notice, like, oh, hey, maybe, like, 7 Mass Frenzies is too much. Then maybe I can cut out, you know, one of these, swap it for something else, and like, all kinds of stuff. Like, yeah, in general, I you don't have to worry about tech too much early on. Just have something nice and simple, and season to taste, I guess. Depending on your support, could be funny. Like, maybe for Burst you have this and, like, some Inspiring Presence, like, from Knife of St. Blanco or something to cover it. I don't know. That might be really iffy. This is very aggro-y support. Using the Avenging Touch to heal, and that's what I'm kind of doing with the recent build. But that's probably not super common. This stuff seems pretty common. Oh, for Burst, this is still really, really nice. This is still really nice. Bad luck. Yeah, awkward block check. But these two, very great. You get the buffs, you get the cards for that person. Does a lot. Still a very nice option for burst. Card advantage stuff. Pyreus really likes Mocad's Unholy Tome. He's figured something out with the Mind Worms that I certainly haven't, so I'll take his word from that. I think I'd rather have Incense this one for the trait instead of the Mind Worm. And yeah, Jester's Cap is who is the person who really showed, like, hey, Tome of the Withering Source, you get awesome trait cycling, and you can just not care about that damage and smack for a lot, and it's cool stuff. He's a cool dude. If there's a lot of melee, this is a nice tech option as well. Get the random purge. And some class bundles. Can be very annoying anti-melee build. But I think generally this is what you'll be seeing. These kind of things. Human, we already talked about good options. Make haste. Bloody Command. I'm not a huge fan of Bloody Command. Like, it'd be nice, but I think I'd rather have... If I'm supporting Warriors, I'm going to want the team movement. And I guess I have the one sprint team, and I guess, like, Training Command, it's... there's only one team movement as well. But it's tokenless, and tokenless is important. For burst stuff... So that's depending on maybe some one-on-one parties or some Warrior parties, but... leadership is a thing if you're really looking for specific cards. I like this one more. You get a trait instead of slowed, and Jump Soldier is just super awesome. Remember, Jump Soldier equals cheating. If you like feeling dirty and doing some nasty stuff, give this a try. It's weird. Like, it feels so subtle. It feels like such a small effect, but oh my god, this thing wins. Games. Depending on, this is a fun, interesting option as well, possibly. Really depends. Okay, I talked for like an hour about that stuff, oh my god. But yeah, so this is the stuff you commonly see. All this, and somehow people do stuff. It's gonna be crazy. I really need to eat lunch now and stuff. Lab mayhem in a bit. So that is that, for reals. Thank you for watching. Math, I played matches earlier! Sorry, you showed up late. Yeah. Remember, Pyreus, I am boring! I'm really boring! So, I just do all the same stuff. And stuff. I did not think to have used Mind Worm effectively. Figure it out. I'll have to give it a shot. Anyways. Yep. Thanks for watching. Hope it was fun. Hope it was useful. Is this deck building stuff interesting for people? Obviously, if you're watching, then, like, yeah. But for the YouTube folks, is that fun? Is that interesting? I don't know. I do hope this was useful. This felt pretty in-depth. I hope. Hope it was good. Math, were they interesting matches? I think one of them was pretty interesting. I think one of them with, like, a control... One of them was interesting. Two of them were not interesting. My losses were horrible, but I think one, maybe two, were interesting. The last ranked game I played was definitely the interesting one. And there might be an interesting one against Razorfin? Maybe? Ranked math. I played like 2 league games and 5 ranked games? Something like that? Yeah. And I lost a league game by timeout. That's always fun, right? Alright! Thanks for watching, everyone! And I'll see you guys next time. Take care.